So far, I explained how to do the independent samples t-test when the sample sizes are the same, but I briefly want to go over some of the implications when they're not the same. So now everything is exactly the same in the example I'm going through now as it was for when the sample sizes are the same, except for the sample sizes are no longer 100. Now there's 31 stats students and 11 research design students, and they also no longer have the same standard deviation as each other. So that we can see what happens because of the different sample sizes. So I've written up all the different steps here, drawn the distributions as far as we can go before we have to worry about the difference in sample sizes. Right, so remember, the null hypothesis just says that the difficulty of the stats exam is the same as the difficulty for the research design exam. So I've drawn those up here. And remember, the independent samples t-test that we're talking about assumes that the standard deviations of the black and the red distribution are the same. And we could call that the pooled standard deviation. So we want to figure out what is that pooled standard deviation. We don't actually know it, so we're going to have to estimate it. And we're going to estimate it based on pooling our two sample standard deviations. When the sample sizes were the same, it was really easy. You just took the average. But now the logic is that a sample that has a larger sample size is going to have a more accurate estimate of the population standard deviation than is a sample with a smaller sample size. And so we're going to weigh these estimates by their sample size, or really by their degrees of freedom. So I'll show you how to do that. And now a trick is we don't actually take the weighted average of the standard deviations, we switch over to the variances, which is why I use these strange numbers here. So the formula for the pooled standard deviation is going to be the variance of the first sample standard deviation times its degrees of freedom divided by the total degrees of freedom plus the variance of the second sample times its degrees of freedom divided by, should be total, I divide the degrees of freedom total. And these are variances, but we want a standard deviation, so we'll have to take the square root of that when we're done. So it'll be really easy to get these variances. We'll just square these numbers. This one will square to be 10. That'll square to be 20. For our degrees of freedom, we'll calculate those quick. So our degrees of freedom 1 is n1 minus 1. So that's 31 minus 1. Our degrees of freedom for number 1 is 30. Our degrees of freedom for 2 is n2 minus 1. 11 minus 1 equals 10. Then our degrees of freedom total is just add these up. So 30 plus 10, we have 40 total degrees of freedom. All right, we'll just plug in the values next. So the variance of sample 1 is 10. 3.16 times 3.16 is 10, times the degrees of freedom for sample 1 is 30 divided by the total degrees of freedom, 40, plus the standard deviation of group 2 squared to get its variance, times the degrees of freedom divided by the total degrees of freedom. And we'll take the square root of that. All right, I'm going to erase this to create a little bit more space. All right, so we have, this would be 300 divided by 40 plus 200 divided by 40. This is 12.5 square root. So that's our best guess at the population standard deviation. And notice, of course, it's in between our two sample standard deviations, but it's closer to the sample standard deviation that had a larger sample size. And I'll illustrate how that works in just a second. So for this example now, we've totally drawn our population distributions, we've got our sample distributions drawn, and now we need to draw the sampling distributions that we would expect. And remember, this for independent samples t-test, the sampling distribution is a distribution of differences between means. It's going to be a t distribution. Its mean is going to be the mean of one population minus the mean of the other population. And according to the null hypothesis, they're the same. So the mean down here is going to be 0. and the standard error is calculated a little bit differently now that we have unequal sample sizes. The calculation of the standard error is a little bit more complicated when you have unequal sample sizes. So it's the pooled variance divided by sample size 1 plus the pooled variance divided by sample size 2. And we need to turn this back into a standard deviation, so it'll be the square root of that. So notice that what we're doing here is we created a single best estimate of what is the one shared population standard deviation. And we did that by more heavily weighing the larger sample size of standard deviation than the smaller sample size of standard deviation. So that's how we created our pooled standard deviation. And now what we're doing is we're creating basically a standard error for one of the populations based on its sample size, and a standard error for the other one based on its sample size, but as variances. That way we can add them together. But in the end, we want these to be standard deviations and not variances, so we're taking the square root. Okay, so let's plug our values in here. So we have 3.54 squared divided by N1 plus 3.54 squared divided by N2 square root. All right, so working through this, if you take 3.54 times itself divided by 31, you get 0.404 plus 3.54 squared divided by 11. That's 1.13. Square that, you get 1.534. Square that, and ultimately, 1.24, 1.24 is the standard error given this sample data. And then if you were to go through all the rest of these steps, right, we've drawn the population distributions, the sample distributions, the sampling distribution is now complete. The critical regions would be on here. And we just add our degrees of freedom from each group together. So we'd have 40 degrees of freedom. We'd go in the t-table and see for a two-tailed test with an alpha of 0.05 what the critical region, what the t-critical values are. And that would determine our critical region. We'd calculate our test statistic, which would be 110 minus 100 divided by 1.24. And then we would decide about our null hypothesis by seeing if our test statistic is more extreme than our critical values. And if so, we'd reject the null hypothesis and decide that stats exams are easier than research design exams. And then as part of the interpretation, we'd calculate the effect size. And for this effect size, recall this is Cohen's D. And it's sample 1 minus sample 2 divided by the population standard deviation. And for that, you'd use the pooled standard deviation we calculated before. So now it would be 110 minus 100 divided by 3.54. And in this case, that's 2.82. So that would mean these sample means are almost 3 standard deviations apart up at the population level. So that would be a huge effect size, a very big effect size. And those are the ways that different sample sizes, when you do independent sample t-test, affect the way you do the calculations. The last thing I want to talk about for the independent samples t-test is just to help give you a better understanding of how creating that pooled standard deviation works and how it's a kind of weighted average. So we'll start off working with the data that we had here. And I'm gonna stick with variances now because for this illustration purposes, variances are a lot more easy to understand because you don't have to be taking the square root of things all the time. So the variance for sample 1 was 10. The variance for sample 2 was 20. The degrees of freedom for sample 1 was 31 minus 1 is 30. And the degrees of freedom for sample 2 was 11 minus 1 is 10. And remember, so to calculate the variance pooled, you take the variance of the first group multiplied by its degrees of freedom divided by the total degrees of freedom, and add that to the variance for the second group multiplied by its own degrees of freedom divided by the total. And so in this case, we're going to have 10 multiplied by 30 over 40 plus 20 multiplied by 10 over 40. We did this before and we got 12.5. So with these numbers, the pooled variance is 12.5. All right, so now to illustrate how this weighting works, what I want to draw out here is possible pooled variance values. So far we had a 12.5, right? I put 10 to 20 because for the sample variances, 10 is at the bottom, 20 is at the top, and so when you're creating a weighted average of these two, it'll never go below 10 or above 20. In fact, if our sample size for the second group was 0, if there's no sample group 2 at all, then our estimate is going to be this 10. And conversely, if we didn't have anybody in the sample, then our estimate of the population's standard variance, then our estimate of the population's variance would be 20, right? And we got this 12.5 because out of our 40 total degrees of freedom, 30 of them were over here. So 3 out of 4. So we moved over that far. If we switch these and have 20 degrees of freedom each, then what happens is these end up being equally weighted. And we would have halfway between 10 and 20. 15 would be the pooled variance. If we switched it so our second group had 30 degrees of freedom and our first one had 10, then this one would be 3 times as influential as this one, right? And it's 20, so we would be over here with if this had 30 degrees of freedom and this had 10. So the relative degrees of freedom is how much the pooled is pulled towards the one extreme versus the other. And if there's equal degrees of freedom, you're right in the middle. And if there's more in one sample, it's drawn that way. More in the other sample, it's drawn the other way. So hopefully this gives you a better sense of how the weighted averaging works when you're calculating those pooled standard deviations if you're doing them for your independent samples t-test.